Step one. Step one.
I just want this whole presidential campaign to be over because I love BET, right? I don't care. It's always in the background. Because I just love any channel that have represent us.
Plus, Baby Boy be on all day.
But no, they can't. I'll shut that down. They shut that down. They don't play it as much now. They don't play it as much.
But wait a minute, Taraji. Let me tell you something. Baby Boy is everything. My favorite piece from there. He don't love me no more. He don't love me no more. That is my piece. Oh, my gosh.
I just don't want... Thank you, April. But I don't want Trump on BET. And right now, he has an ad on BET. And
that's a problem.
And every time I look up, I'm like, why is he on BET?
So wait a minute. Taraji, you're absolutely, there is a piece to me that I don't understand. First of all, I think we need to push for every state to put civics back into the classroom because we don't understand the process. And it makes me so angry. But two, there is the smoke and mirrors. This president is a liar, point blank. He is a liar. But we are taking it, and I don't know why. He is looking to get the black vote, particularly black men, and he's got a certain percentage, double digit number. I need someone to help me understand. Black women see through the smoke and mirrors. We're like, uh-huh.
Can you believe those numbers? I don't know if
yes, I do. Yes, I do. Taraji, go ahead, Mark.
I believe these numbers, and I'm gonna tell you. I mean, they could be a little bit high because some of it is divisive. But
he's a liar. I don't believe nothing.
And nah, I hear that.
Last time he got 13%.
I believe he pays people. He pays the numbers to go in his way. He's that narcissistic. So I'm questioning everything. So go ahead.
My only concern is, first of all, to me, if the number is 5%, that's too high, right?
Right.
Like, what would make somebody, because they weren't even that high under other presidents, right? I mean, if black men aren't voting for John McCain and not voting for Mitt Romney at this rate, they did vote for Reagan at this rate, but why would they suddenly decide Donald Trump? That's what scares me. And this is something that black men have to be self-aware about and self-critical about. And that is sometimes and it's the same thing that happens with taxes, right? Is that you will have somebody that makes $10 an hour working at Perkins or Wendy's complaining about tax cuts and death taxes and all this stuff when they're not the ones who are going to benefit from this thing, right? If right now Joe Biden is saying that no one who makes under $400,000 is going to have a tax increase. So if you make under $400,000, you should be fine. But it's people out there that make $30,000 that are saying, no, why are the millionaires getting taxed? This isn't fair. This isn't American, right? There's a way that we aspire to be that thing. And because we aspire to be that thing, we base our whole identity around that thing that we're not at our own expense, right? So you got poor white people. Back in the 80s, poor white people would vote against welfare, thinking that they were voting against poor black people, when in fact they were voting against those white women in West Virginia and Ohio and all these other places. Because because the public good is racialized, right? So if something is seen as for the public good, they see it as for black folk. And so white folk will close ranks around their whiteness so that they can feel good about being white, even if they're catching more hell than the black people they think they're voting against. So this all becomes part of the equation. Now that to black men, it's the same thing. Sometimes when we complain about Harvey Weinstein, you know, getting in trouble and not Bill Cosby, or Bill Cosby getting in trouble, not Harvey Weinstein, it's because we're not caring about black women and we're not caring about freedom. Our vision of freedom is to be as reckless and dangerous, as violent as white men. So our freedom dream, to use Robin Kelly, the historian's language, is our freedom dream has to be more humane and more robust than that. Amen. My dream of freedom can't be to be an oppressor, right? Because a lot of time, a lot of us aren't dreaming about being free. We're dreaming about being in charge. We want to be the oppressor. We want to be the one with the foot on somebody's neck. I don't want to give the gun to the rabbit. I don't want to reverse the relations of oppression. I want everybody to be free. But sometimes as black men, we see Donald Trump and we be like, yo, if I could only be that free, if I could be that much of an asshole, if I could be that unchecked, if I could be that violent, then I could.
But some of them, unfortunately, Mark, some of them are doing what he is. So, well, if the president's doing it, then if he's doing this, okay, I can do it. Do you think there's some kind of, right, is there some kind of rationale where I look like Donald Trump? Is that what you're saying some of these black men are feeling? I look like, act like?
We want to. It's like, there's a book called Pedagogy of Oppressed by Paulo Freire, a great Brazilian writer and philosopher. And he said, for the oppressed to be is to be like. In other words, if you're oppressed, your only vision of what humanity is the person who oppresses you. I don't know what freedom looks like outside of white people. I don't know what freedom looks like outside of men. I don't know what freedom looks like outside of X, Y, and Z. And so too often, Black men are going in that booth and pulling the lever for Donald Trump because we have deep down some sick desire to be as free as he is. When in fact, if we had a more humane vision of freedom, we would say that the best world we could be is one where Black women are just as free as we are, where all women are just as free as we are, where poor people have access to living wages, right? Where no one is victimized by who they love or how they love or what their sexual identity is or what how they perform gender. That should be our freedom dream, but it's not. And that's why I see these Black men who watch The Apprentice and these rappers that used to want to be like Donald Trump. I mean, you've been saying it for 30 years, right? And so now people are still going to the voting booth, pulling the lever, even though their grandmom died from COVID. Even though their friends don't got no job.
And then you have the wealthy who mm-hmm. are Black, and they're just going to vote for their own interests. We're trying to save
Facts.
Our offspring, and he really clearly doesn't care. And the likes of him, people who are just voting to save their little sorry wealth that they only get to enjoy while they're breathing this air, because you can't take it with you. So to garner all of that wealth, and then to choose an administration that is not even going to honor that wealth or this planet so that your offspring can enjoy it in the future. So what's the point?
I think Donald has done a good job of, unfortunately, of convincing Black men that he is going to be their best option. So much of politics, unfortunately, it is sales. And no matter what you think of Donald Trump, he knows how to do sales. And so he released 60 people, 60 Black men out of prison, and he tries to come off like Black Jesus. We let out over 1,000 Black men. And what I say to my Black brothers, you have to know the numbers. And you will not survive another 4 years of Donald Trump. You will not survive. This violence against you, he has made it very clear, it is okay to hurt and kill Negroes. He has made it clear. It's not a coincidence that we're dying at record numbers, unarmed, and he's in the White House. He's made it very clear. Nobody, you'd have to go back over like 100 years to when some presidents were openly in the KKK. And they were sworn into the KKK in the Oval Office, to where you have a scenario where a guy has not denounced white supremacy. And if you're Black and you're voting for a white man that has not denounced white supremacy or even acknowledged Black Lives Matter, then there is something seriously wrong with you. Seriously wrong with you. And you just need to just go check yourself back on to the Trump plantation.
But what is seriously wrong with this is no matter what happens in the election, Black America is fearing a potential race riot. No. Why? Because no, they are, because this president has stoked it using the words that he does. You've got people out there trying to create fear in Black America at the polls. I'm so thankful that the state of Michigan has banned open carry, intimidation at the polls in the state of Michigan. Who does that?
I don't think anybody has to worry about that.
In the 50s and 60s. We have to worry about the Proud Boys. We have to worry about things like Kenosha. We have to worry about Portland, Oregon. This is just one step. Trumpism will be here for a minute. It's not just this moment. Byron.
I don't think you can live in fear. If you live in fear, that's another
form. I'm just saying.
Okay. So we have to just understand that may or may not happen, but whatever, move on. And we can't live in fear. I'm sorry, you were saying, Taraji?
No, I was just gonna say, I hear you, April. And that's something that I, as a mother of a young Black man out here, living his life, I won't allow myself to go there, because the difference now is that you don't know who's on your side, right? We have a lot of allies who look like Proud Boys. So I don't think that would be a smart move on
their I'm talking about the ones that clearly follow him. I'm talking about the ones that have no gumption going to the state house and carrying open carry.
It's not, there is no surprise attack no more now because people's eyes are open. What happened at that march, like people are alert. So I don't want us to be living fear. Be alert, but don't fear. There's nothing to fear.
As a news person, getting what I see, and Natasha, I'm sure you see the same thing. We read these stories. Mm-hmm. We read what could happen. Beyond the president saying, I don't know if I'm going to leave the White House, there are, you know, we've seen a potential assassination attempts of
that have been foiled.
But, you know, there are other names
that doesn't exist. Just don't want people to.
I'm not living in fear, but this is a news story. These are legitimate news stories that come in front of us, and we need to be made aware and understand that we are 2020, 1950, 1960. That's the problem. We're going backwards instead of forwards. Bill Clinton tried to do this race initiative where he understood the browning of America. People went crazy over the fact that Barack Obama was president. And now we're not post-racial, we're post-Obama. What does it look like? It looks like this. And what is this? This is racism at its height. This is not even George Wallace. George Wallace apologized on his deathbed. This man has no empathy, no understanding, no care about what he does. Black women, sons of bitches, black women are talking. Thank God, Kristen Welker tore that thing up the other night. She was strong, a black woman.
Mm-hmm. And April, I can assure you, he's gonna lose. Trump's gonna lose. It's gonna be a landslide. He'll be lucky if he cracks 200 electoral votes. And when he loses, he will be leaving the White House. Don't worry about
it. Oh, he's going to leave by armed guard or by walking out.
They're going to snatch him up out of there.
Don't worry about that. He's going to lose. It's going to be a landslide because we're going to vote. We're going to donate. The thing we got to focus on, we have to make sure we hand Biden and Harris the Senate, because here is where we are as black people. I just want to remind us where we are. We're on the precipice of having the first female president, vice president of the United States, be a black woman. And when she becomes the first female vice president of the United States, she will be positioned for greater success to be the first female president of the United States, a black woman. This is such a powerful moment for black America that when we get this right and we capture this moment, we will not look back ever again, because we are woke and we're not gonna lose this Super Bowl when we're on the 1 yard line. We're walking this baby in, okay? We're getting this done. Black America, we're showing up, we're voting, we're donating, and we're not gonna lose this moment, because this is what they expect us to do. They think we're a bunch of idiots. They pimp us. All these black men out here voting for Donald Trump, let me be really clear, you getting pimped. You getting pimped, okay? No other way, you getting, there's nothing. You haven't even read his tax code. I know his tax code.
Well, his tax returns, because he hasn't given them. But anyway.
If I've never paid tax returns, I'd be a billionaire too.
Right. I'm not even, okay, like, I'll tell you something in his tax return, his new tax. So let me just say it like this. So black men, you think you want to roll like that? Okay, you know what's in his new tax bill? His tax bill, it addresses people who want to buy private jets for $50 million.
Right.
So instead of amortizing the cost of that $50 million jet over 5 years, he said, hey, you can depreciate that jet in one day, meaning you could shelter $50 million in income because you bought a private jet. How many brothers are running around buying $50 million private jets? You need to read his tax code and you will know it wasn't written for your black ass.
So my jet is right outside.
Wasn't written for your black ass. I don't know why your black ass is voting for somebody who wrote a tax code. Oh, I'll tell you what. And when he said wealthy people can write down a jet, a $50 million jet, think about that. You buy a jet for $50 million, the government just gave it to you for the most part. He cut over $1 billion in after-school programs, which mainly impacted black kids and put black kids on the street. So when I say to your black ass, you need to read the tax code, because I happen to know the tax code really well, okay? I'm telling you, that tax code is not taking care of your black ass, unless you're a billionaire. And if you're not a billionaire, you rolling in the wrong direction when it comes to Trump. I'm just saying.
I put the word wealth. You said wealth. Black people don't have a lot of wealth. A lot of us are rich. There is a difference.
And Taraji, you nailed it. Let me just say, because I just talked to some young black kids from HBCU, and we spent a couple of hours the other night. And I said, you got to understand, black people, like, we have cash flow. Like, you'll have a good 5-year run, 10-year run, you make some money. That's cash flow. That you just had a good run. White people have wealth. What is wealth? I know people like, they're like 3, 4, 5 billion, 10 billion liquid. Their money is making $1.5 billion a year. Their money, like you getting pimped, right? When white people are pimping money, okay? There's a big difference. Black people, broke as hell. Broke as hell. You don't have a pot to piss in or a window to throw it out of. You'll have a couple of, like, you might have some 40, 50, 60 million dollar years. You are broke as hell.
I'm broke. I'm telling you, straight up, broke as hell.
I know white people sitting on 10, 20 billion cash liquid, making 10 million a day off their money. So
Byron,
his tax
plan is thought out here for him.
What'd you say?
I said, we know it's hard out here for a pimp trying to make the money for the rent. We know that. But at the end of the day.
She had to do it. She had to.
But we get it. Wealth is something that you take, that you give your children and your children's children. Yeah. It's generational. We, like you said, we got the cash flow to buy this little hoopty over here, or maybe even a Rolls or a Bentley.
Yeah.
But then when it comes time to send them to Morgan State or Howard or somewhere, oh my God, what do I do?
Right.
It doesn't flow like that for us. We don't have discretionary spending.
And I just want to make this point. Black America, you're broke because you are positioned to be broke. Can't get that bank loan. That's why I was all over Obama. And I said, Obama, I need you to audit the banks and see if the banks are lending money to black people, not minorities, because minorities are defined as white women. So you're positioned to fail. But real quick, I want to talk about the great work that Taraji's doing with mental health, because we have a mental health problem and we have a severe mental health issue in our country where we're not addressing mental health. We're not supporting people with mental health issues. We are just incarcerating people. We are flushing people down the toilet, and we have to address the mental health epidemic that we have in our country. And Taraji, you've been leading the way. Please share some thoughts on that.
Well, it's layered when it comes to us, because we are dealing with over 400 years of trauma that has been passed down generationally. So things that we don't even know that we've inherited, we have. It affects our relationships. It affects not just romantic relationships, friendships. It affects our psyche. And not being able to talk about it, and this whole idea of strength, you know, we're afraid to be vulnerable. That's where the strength lies, and being able to say, I'm scared, or I'm afraid, or I need help. You know, we, for so long, religion has been our therapist, and that's just not healthy at all. And so, you know, I've just felt like something needed to be done. My father suffered. He was a Vietnam vet, and he suffered. Back then it was called manic depression, but now they've advanced the research, and that's been now known as what we call today bipolar, bipolarism or bipolar. And I named the foundation after him. And
what's the name of your foundation? What's the name
Boris
of your
foundation? The Boris Lawrence Henson Foundation.
And it's a nonprofit, and people can go online and make a donation there.
Yes, at borislhensonfoundation.org.
Please support her foundation. She does great, great work for people in our community who are seriously dealing with some bad problems on the mental health side. But I'm sorry, Taraji, go for it.
No, I was just saying we're trying to eradicate the stigma first and foremost because we don't talk about it. And we are broken and we need the most help. And I just felt like if I shared my story and put a face to it, I mean, I think people trust me and they look up to me and my work. And I just felt like something had to be done. Someone has to say it, and why not me? And I mean, what we found, I guess for me, the determining point or the breaking point for me, or feeling like forcing me to do something, was when it was time to look for a therapist for myself and for my son. And it was very, very difficult to find one of color, and not even really color, but a culturally competent therapist. It just seemed like I could not find one in the state or somewhere close. I had to drive hours, or they were in another state or wherever. And I was like, that's because we don't talk about it. I talked to my best friend of 7 years who's dealt with anxieties from since we've been best friends in the seventh grade. And we both agreed it's because we don't talk about it at home. So our children don't even go off to study in the field because the stigma is so thick that we just can't even talk about it at home. And so, and then another breaking point for me was the suicide rate amongst our youth. I had, as a Black mother, I had to do something. And so we created this foundation. Then once COVID happened, you know, people need help, they're losing jobs, and isolation is not your friend. And so we decided to do a virtual fundraiser, and we raised an incredible amount of money, and we gave away 5 free sessions because we felt like this was the time if you were feeling reluctant to even looking or trying therapy, we felt like being in the comforts of your own home would make you feel a little more inclined to at least try. So we gave 5 therapy sessions, and 95% of the people who signed up said they would continue their session. And that's what we wanted. We wanted to, you know, and I'm starting to see people talk about it more. Then what happened, and I'm gonna wrap it up, but then we realized that 93% of the people that were signing up were women and only 7% men. And you know, I'm trying to reach the brothers. Because I love our men. I'm raising one. I miss my dad dearly, and I was a daddy's girl. So we did another round where we just catered to the men, because I feel like sometimes men just won't speak up, you know? And so we did the mother nurturing thing. We said, okay, brothers, this is only for you. And I'm telling you, overwhelmingly, we had to shut it down because we were full, and we're about to start our second round. So I am just, that makes me happy. That makes me feel like, forget acting. I feel like acting got me to this place to you. This is like my life purpose, I feel like. I really do. And it brings me joy to see everybody talking about it now and coming out. You're starting to see more people talk about it and not be afraid. And, you know, Facebook just greenlit my show, and we're going to talk about some things, because I'm going to tell you one thing. Before I leave this earth, we're going to get some healing. We deserve it. It is time. It is time for us to heal. We have to heal, because if we don't, you're going to keep passing down this trauma to your kids and the generation. Somebody has to be strong enough to break the cycle.
Mm-hmm. And how much did you raise?
Oh God, I mean, I can't remember, because the checks keep coming in. Like, I think because there was a point where we first started, we blew all of the money. We did raise a lot of money. We raised like $500,000 when I first launched the campaign. But then we had to make a splash to let people know, hey, we're here and we're mean business. So we had to throw this huge convention in DC, which went really well. We touched a lot of people. We got, and that's how we built our database that's on our a resource guide on our website. If you're seeking or searching, or you're in need of a therapist, we did all the work for you. We've garnered all of the incredible psychiatrists who prescribe you medicine and therapists who you talk to every week. We have a resource guide where you can go. We've all vetted them all. We have an amazing board of psychiatrists and therapists who have vetted all of the doctors, and you can go and pick one. And it's like finding a relationship. That's what I tell people, because that can be daunting. You know, you think you go meet the first person and it's a vibe. It's like a relationship. It took me years to find my therapist. But it, right. you know, you have to invest that kind of time in yourself because again, ain't nobody gonna save you.
Now look at Black America. So we don't need anybody to save us. We can save ourselves. If 1 million of us go and donate $10, that's $10 million for this unbelievable platform that she has built. If 10 million of us lean in and go, here's $10, that's $100 million where we're investing in ourselves and our community and we're dealing with our pain. Because what's happening is it's manifesting itself in alcoholism and drugs and drug overdose and violence and incarceration and homelessness. Like this is a multi-billion dollar issue. You have so many people who are dealing with mental health challenges and we will not move ahead until we address it. She is a hero for being so open and coming out and addressing it. Now we as Black people, we gotta lean in. We gotta say, hey Taraji, what can I do here? What's your website? What's the name of your website again?
BorisLHenson.org. And let me just say this, when you pass a homeless person on the street, don't look at them as a bum or someone who's strung out on drugs. I'm gonna tell you, a large percentage of them are people who lost their job, their medical benefits, and they can't get to their medicine. It ain't got nothing to do with drugs. And then when you say drugs, there's levels to it. When you say drugs, a lot of times people are taking drugs because they have a mental, they're trying to quiet the noise.
That's right.
So then you got a lot of parents who have kids who are drug addict on drugs, but they're there because they don't even, so if we don't know that this mental piece is huge, if we don't address it, we're going to keep losing our kids. Or they're going to keep trying to self-medicate because we just don't know. We don't know.
And when you know better, you know.
And you have to invest. We have to invest as a community. We have to invest in us. We can't act like this is going to get fixed without us making the investment. We have to invest in our children's education. If 10 million of us donate $10 a month, that's $100 million a month. That's $1.2 billion a year. You can graduate every kid in HBCU every year with us giving $10 a month. Why are we as Black people not giving $10 a month so we can educate our kids? Why are we not giving $10 a month to make sure that we are addressing the mental health crisis in our community, trying to deal with the unbelievable torture and pain of hundreds of years of slavery? We have to invest. But the good news is we have the money. We, Black America, you don't need anybody to save you. We can save ourselves, lean in. And I'm not talking about a lot of money because there's a lot of us. And when we give $10 to educate ourselves or to make sure that we are addressing mental health, then it's a game changer. Or our politicians, we have to invest, lean in.
Well, I'm going to tell you, that's literally, I'm sorry, and then I'm going to leave. I got to go. You keep trying to drag me out of here. But I'm going to say this. No, what you're saying, Byron, is important because I said we raised $500,000 on our own. Then we had to do the convention. We spent all the money on that. I got nervous because I was like, oh my God, how are we going to keep this thing afloat? Like people are expecting us to do all of these great things and then COVID hit. And then it was like, okay, people are suffering. We had to put everything. We had this huge agenda. We were going back to Congress for legislature for our children to get therapists in schools, not counselors, not somebody that's going to send a pipeline straight to prison by having a classroom full of Black boys labeled, you know, special ed. You know, we need therapists in place in school to recognize trauma in a child, to say, you know, something is wrong with this kid, something, and to deal with that accordingly, right? Instead of calling the police, right? So we had a whole agenda. Then COVID hit. That money that we raised, that second $500,000 that we raised that's taking care of us is our money. That was people donating $5 here, $20 here. My mother had a birthday. She said, for my birthday, she donated $1,000. It was that kind of grassroots. And then what happened, I started doing press. Then Toyota and all these other great big names started sending the big checks. because we're actually doing the work. But I just want you to say, I don't want to ever say donate. I need you to understand that we're really doing the work. We're trying to work with the court systems, with the recidivism rate in prison, and play so we don't send people with mental illnesses to prison. And again, like I said, with the getting therapists, qualified therapists in schools with our children, and also getting curriculum in school about mental health, which will force the family to talk about mental health at home, because they're bringing homework home that addresses it. And also, lastly, I could talk about this forever, I'm so passionate, but lastly, scholarships for our children to study in the field, so that we don't have these issues of where do I go when I need help, no one knows what I've been through. So that's that. And I love you guys, and I really have to go. I stayed on long.
Listen, I just want to say thank you, Queen Taraji. You. I love you. I appreciate you. And we're going to put the right people in office. So when you go to fight for us, we're going to get it done.
Yes. Thank you, guys. Stay safe and let's keep up the good fight. And everybody vote, damn it.
Thank you, Taraji.
Love you. Bye-bye.
Bye, Taraji.
And thank you, April. Thank you so much for your insight. Mark, thank you for your powerful, powerful story and all the work that you've done. And Byron, thank you for creating this forum to let people know that it's not just about our self-interest, how we're doing individually, but it's about community uplift. Right. Thank you, Grio family, for tuning in to Vote for Your Life. Make sure you get out to those polls and spread the word. Bye, everybody.
I appreciate you all. Thank you. Please vote.
Bye.
Bye.